Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Fletcher.
I'm Zachary.
I'm Jake.
And I'm Rob.
Today, we present our conclusions in the case of Mr. Leib Goldstein. Mr. Goldstein is 65 years old and has suffered from an Alzheimer's type dementia for the last 10 years. He is currently unresponsive and in the hospital due to advanced heart disease. His daughter, Ms. Shayna Goldstein, is legally authorized to make medical decisions on his behalf. Mr. Goldstein is presently on life support. An intra-aortic balloon pump, or an IABP, has been inserted to assist his heart, and he's on a respirator. His team of doctors have informed Ms. Goldstein that her father is now stable enough to undergo a bypass operation should she wish to proceed with this operation. She also has two other options. She could choose to leave in the IABP, which is used to sustain life, but will likely fail for a week. Mr. Goldstein would also remain unconscious for the remainder of his life. Her third option is to remove the IABP and attempt to manage Mr. Goldstein's heart disease with medication, but this option will not halt the progression of his disease. He would be awake for the remaining duration of his lifespan, and his doctors have predicted he is 50% likely to die within the next 30 days. They have concluded that Ms. Goldstein must select either the first or the third option. Further, the court urges her to opt for the bypass operation instead of attempting to manage her father's heart condition with medication.
In regard to all three options, one of the first things we looked for was whether or not the option attempted to prevent death through a lasting solution. Tosafot Abogazara 27b states that we must choose the possibility of life over certain death. As Jews, we are commanded to value the potential of a lasting solution, not a temporary fix that leads to certain death. The bypass operation offers the best opportunity to save the life of Mr. Goldstein, and we will show this is supported by rabbinic sources, even though he is an end-stage Alzheimer's disease. It is our contention that to leave in the IABP is not an acceptable option, since Mr. Goldstein's death will be imminent and inevitable, and its use will not sustain the life of Mr. Goldstein. In this instance, the IABP will act as an impediment to one who is GOSIS, and we have other viable alternatives. As we learn in Sefer Hasidim 7.23.4, they must remove the chopper from there, and they must not consult of his tongue, in order that he will not die. Since continued use of the IABP will result in certain death, we should remove it to allow Mr. Goldstein to achieve a mitayapa, a death of dignity, as referenced in Tzitz Eliezer 13.89.
Ms. Goldstein understood that there could be more than one permissible option under Jewish law. She has asked us to render an opinion so that she can make a choice for her father, which, in her estimation, is a decision he would make for himself if he were in a position to do so. Managing Mr. Goldstein's heart condition with medication may be a viable option if Ms. Goldstein chose not to put her father through the risk and trauma of open heart surgery. It would allow him to be awake, although he would have to remain in the hospital. His doctors predict that this alternative would result in the likelihood that Mr. Goldstein would not live longer than 30 days, so it may be of questionable value. In the CCAL responsa on the treatment of the terminally ill, the rabbis have noted that the traditional emphasis on active and passive measures has given way to a modern interpretation of the nature and purpose of those actions. We would argue that if Ms. Goldstein felt that her father would not want to go through the intensity and risks of open heart surgery, she could opt for treatment through medication alone. However, the medication will not improve the quality of Mr. Goldstein's life, which is why this Moot Beit Din concludes that the bypass operation is a more viable solution. We are aware of the argument that because of Mr. Goldstein's Alzheimer's type dementia, his quality of life has been diminished. We could argue that he is like the patient facing a second amputation, as referenced in the responsa of Rabbi Shlomo Auerbach in Rabbi Brody's article, Jewish Casuistry on Suicide and Euthanasia. However, we believe that unlike the patient facing amputation, he is not experiencing the prospect of terrible pain. And advances are being made all the time to improve the quality of life for individuals with Alzheimer's disease. We believe that Mr. Goldstein is entitled to the best care available. and his late-stage Alzheimer's-type dementia should not be a deterrent for providing him with appropriate medical care for his heart condition, as we learned in Yigor of Moshe, CM 274. It is obvious and clear that we are obligated to heal and save any human being without any distinction as to competence.
We also understand that Ms. Goldstein has given up many years of her own life to care for her father as his health has declined. We admire her for being willing to sacrifice her own career in order to help her father as best as she possibly could. By choosing to attempt to manage her father's disease with medication, she would be leaving him in the hands of God. Again, she should only choose this option if she felt that she was complying with his wishes. Full recovery from the current state of his heart condition is unlikely through a course of treatment that relies on administering medicine alone. Mr. Goldstein's doctors have made it clear that he would likely die in a month's time. As awful as it sounds, Ms. Goldstein would have her life forever. But we are keenly aware that this is not her motivation, as indicated by her ongoing commitment to her father. She has demonstrated that she wants the best possible outcome for her father, and we feel that she should choose the bypass operation. We recognize that even with a successful outcome, Mr. Goldstein will still be facing the challenges of an Alzheimer's type dementia. However, this surgery will significantly increase his lifespan and offer some quality of life to Mr. Goldstein. Ms. Goldstein will still have to care for him, but she will no longer have to constantly worry about his approaching passing. Although it is risky, the doctors have given an estimation of over a 50% success rate for this surgery, even given Mr. Goldstein's current medical history. Thus, according to Rabbi Chaim Jacker, as referenced in his article, High Risk Medical Procedures, the operation is allowed under Jewish law. Therefore, we urge Ms. Goldstein to proceed with the bypass operation instead of managing her father's heart condition with medication alone, as long as she feels this is in compliance with these wishes. Thank you for your consideration.
You guys referred to option B as option B as preventing, me talking about preventing a death with injury because he would be suffering. Do you think there's a time element involved in mitayrafah? In other words, if he's going to die in a week or in 30 days, is there ever a time where mitayrafah can be defined as just let him die faster, as opposed to give him the extra time, but let's say not have the imminent failure?
So I think that as far as mitayrafah goes, and we also talked, what we didn't talk about was also chayishah, which is defined as about 2 days. Mitayacha being a death of dignity. I think Hayesha Amor plays into the time element of how much risk can you take, which we define by Rhyme Time Chapter. Mitayacha, in my opinion, is more not letting a person die as a person with tubes, as a person whose leg is artificially treating them. So in direct response to your question, no, I don't think that there's a specified or exact time that one must have to achieve Mitayacha. It is simply that one should die a respectful death that God has made them to die.
So you also, you mentioned that you thought the IABP was actually an impediment, correct?
Yes.
So I have two questions on that. How is it an impediment if it would lead to the quickest death of those options that are there? And the second part of that question, if you said that it is not permissible for a variety of reasons, how would option C be permissible if he's going to pass anyway and the medication would seemingly be the impediment to him dying? Does that the question make sense? Okay.
Okay, so the difference between the IABP and the medication is that the IABP is working to keep him alive. Without it, his heart would fail and his system would basically shut down. The medication is in place to sort of assist his system, but his system is functioning on his own. So he is not living because of another machine or another doctor or another person. He's living his own life. And the medication is assisting in ways that are permitted by Jewish law. However,
reference what we refer to as the woodcutter story, the whole collection of laws regarding assault in the tongue, the Beit Knesset, the piece of Beit Knesset under the pillow. You're allowed to remove an impediment, but you're not allowed to be, you're not allowed to put salt under the tongue to keep them alive. In this case, the medication is not acting like a salt in his tongue because he is helping his system revert to its natural state, allowing him to die a natural death.
You presented, you took into account the daughter's concerns, Shayna's concerns,
yes.
And did you find, when you were preparing that part of your argument, that there was halakhic source that focused on her concerns being a factor?
Yes. One thing that we also took into consideration was honoring the father and mother, which is important in Jewish law. And then also, it talks about how saving a life trumps everything in Avodah Zarah 27b. So we sort of took that into consideration by saying that she must do what she can to attempt to save his life, and that you can't stand idly by the blood of your peer. And so the best case, even though it may not be as beneficial in her life, in order to properly honor her father and not stand idly by, she must do all that she can to save and maximize his life.
Despite her own, yes.
But if I can add, the furthermore, response from Minhag Shlomo 286-2-3, Baruch Haray Shlomo from Arbach, points out that we must choose the best option as if we were acting as the patient themselves. So we have to ask, Shayna has to ask, none of us are Shayna. It is actually up to Shayna herself to choose what is in her father's best interest while acting as her father herself. I mean, she's the one that we've proven that knows her father the best.